so. Thank you.
I will.
I
For those worshiping online, today's service leaflet can be viewed at chapelsjd.org/service-leaflets. We welcome you.
Blessed be our God,
forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this, your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper, and shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there are many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what he have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others hid their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne out our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent. So he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death, and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My God, why have you forsaken me? A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who, in every respect, has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword back into his sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So the soldiers, their officer, and the Judean police arrested Thank you.
Please be seated. May truth only be spoken, truth only heard. Amen. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Truth is a major theme in the fourth gospel. The word truth occurs 25 times in John's gospel, compared to only 7 occurrences in the other 3 gospels combined. Pilate's question, although apparently sincere, is wrongly put. You cannot give a good answer to a bad question. As with many moderns, Pilate assumes that truth is a what, that it has an objective content that can be clearly stated, like a bumper sticker I once saw that read, God said it, I believe it, that settles it, full stop, end of discussion. There are, of course, many others in contemporary Western society who prefer to think of truth in relative, situational, or malleable terms, like alternative truth, perhaps, but which is all too frequently defined to suit one's own circumstances, preferences, and/or prejudices. Neither of these, however, is the understanding of truth in John's Gospel, where Jesus is never said to teach the truth. He does not deliver the truth to his disciples, nor are the latter ever said to have held the truth. Truth is not an object, something to be possessed. Jesus was not a great teacher who gave his followers pithy truths or precepts to live by. Instead, Jesus gave himself, for Jesus is God's truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life, says the joining Jesus. Jesus is the embodiment of God, God in human flesh and blood. In seeing Jesus, we are in truth beholding God. When Philip, on behalf of the other disciples, asked Jesus to show us the Father and we will be satisfied, Jesus responds, "Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his work. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. In truth, I tell you, the one who believes in me will do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater acts than these, because I am going to the Father." Truth, therefore, is a who and not a what, a matter of personal encounter and relationship, a matter of worship and commitment that is experienced through the power of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit who guides Jesus' disciples into all truth. Truth is a matter of doing, of ethics, of wanting to do the will of God, and not merely a series of abstract principles that one may weigh objectively and then decide whether or not Jesus is teaching the truth. There is great irony, then, in the scene where Pilate asks what truth is, when the one who is the truth of God stands before him. On Good Friday, truth is incarnate, takes the weight of human suffering and pain, offering truth's self as a full and perfect sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Here, truth accepts the awful consequences of human pettiness, sin, and hatred. On Good Friday, we see what evil is capable of, what evil leads to. "Surely he has borne our infirmities and diseases," says the prophet Isaiah.
He was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole. By his bruises we are healed. On the cross, truth takes to itself the whole painful saga of humanity's violence, cruelty, selfishness, and sin. When faced with brutality, truth does not fight back. Again, in the words of Isaiah, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, like a lamb that is led to slaughter, like a sheep before its shearers is silent. So he did not open his mouth. When surrounded by hatred, truth does not retaliate. When oppressed by injustice, truth offers forgiveness. It is as if all the destructive forces of evil are lumped together, and God says, it is enough. This is where the chain of hatred, the ugliness of sin, and the power of death ends. There is no place in the universe, no created being, which is beyond the redeeming act of love of Jesus Christ. Through his wounds, we are healed. What then is our response to Good Friday? We might be tempted to mourn the death of a beloved friend or family member, a brother perhaps. Carried away by the horrors and agony of the cross. But as solemn as the occasion is, that would miss the point of Good Friday, for good is truly what this day is. Today is a victory, not a defeat. Ancient hymnody often speaks of Good Friday as the day of our salvation. The day when humanity's greatest enemy, the power of sin, is overcome forever. The cross is not portrayed as a grisly instrument of torture, but as a noble tree, the emblem of life, our triumph and our hope. In medieval art and glass, the wood of the cross is sometimes depicted with budding leaves and the color green, both symbolic of new life. As one hymn states it, faithful cross, crux fidelis, above all others, one and noble tree, none in foliage, none in blossom, none in fruit thy peer may be. Sweetest wood, sweetest iron, sweetest weight is hung on thee. And so today let us rejoice. Today, let us rest in the love of God, which holds nothing back, which never abandons us. Today, let us lift our voices in praise and adoration to the God who loves and redeems us. We adore you, O Christ. We bless you. Because of your holy cross, you have redeemed the world. Let us pray that we also might reflect some of Christ's love in our own lives and world. Let us pray for courage and selflessness, and the audacity to love, especially where love is lacking, among the poor, the forgotten, and the outcast. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to bear witness to the truth, said Jesus to Pilate. We too are born to love. We too are created to bear witness to the power and truth of God's love, which not only created and sustains us, but heals our infirmities and redeems us. On this good night, let us recommit ourselves to the power of love, to the truth of love, to the truth that first loved us. Amen.
Oh,
that the world through him might be saved, that all who believe in him might be delivered from the power of sin and death, and become heirs with him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere, according to their needs. Let us pray for the Holy Catholic Church of Christ throughout the world, for its unity in witness and service, for all bishops and other ministers, and the people whom they serve, for our bishops and all the people of this diocese, for all Christians in this community, for those about to be baptized, that God will confirm his church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace. Let us then in silence pray. Almighty and everlasting God, by His Spirit, the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified. Receive our supplications and prayers, which we offer before all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you. Through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth, and for those in authority among them, for Joseph, the President of the United States, for the Congress and the Supreme Court, for the members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth, and live in peace and comfort. Let us stand in silence. Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your dominion may increase, until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body or in mind, for the hungry and the homeless, the destitute and the oppressed, for the sick, the wounded and the crippled, for those in loneliness, fear and anguish, for those who face temptation, doubt and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and captives, and those in mortal danger, that God in His mercy will comfort and relieve them, and grant them the knowledge of His love, and comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer. Let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Merciful God, creator of all the peoples of the earth and lovers of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you, as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us
commit
ourselves to our God.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery, by the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. This is the wood of the cross upon which hung the Savior of the world. Come, let us This is the word of the cross upon which hung the Savior of the world. Come, let us worship. This is the word of the cross upon which hung the Savior of the world.
Come, let us worship.
Thank you. prays that your passion, cross, and death, between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, pardon and rest to the dead. To your holy church, peace and concord, and to us sinners, everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and